Now with properties under addition, which we have seen in the previous case, foreclosure property, associative property, existence of identity, inverse and commutative property. Similar are the properties which you're going to see even under multiplication. So let's start with the properties studied under rational numbers, because rational numbers are the base for all the sets of different numbers which we have discussed in the previous session. So when we see the first property under multiplication, the first property is closure property. Now in this case, I take two elements from Q, that is two numbers which belong to the rational numbers Q, then my closure property says that A into B will also belong to Q. The operation here is multiplication denoted with dot. Next. When I see the next property, which is associative property, we know that associative property requires three basic elements. So let me take the three elements to be A, B, C belonging to Q. Now just whatever property we have discussed in addition, the same property holds here, but instead of plus, replaced with into or multiplication. So the property goes as A into B into C would be equal to A into B into C, which is associative property for three different elements belonging to Q. Next. And the third property which we have discussed is existence of identity. Now, identity is a very important property which, if you go with the recap, the same identity here also is equally important under multiplication. So, when we understand the multiplicative identity, I just understand that if I take an element A belonging to Q, then whatever I multiply here must give back A. This is how the identity property is understood. So, what should I multiply inside the bracket to get back A? Is what defines identity property. As we all know that A multiplied with 1 would definitely give me A. Therefore, in this case of multiplication, 1 is said to be the multiplicative identity or the identity under multiplication, which is nothing but 1 times of A. This is how the existence of identity is understood under multiplication in Q. Next. Next comes existence of inverse. Now inverse holds only when identity holds. So assuming that one is already existing in Q, we go with the inverse property. Now inverse property says that if I have A belonging to Q and one belonging to Q, then whatever I multiply here must give back 1. So I should identify the element what I need to multiply in this bracket, which gives me 1. So what should come here is what is understood for inverse property. So I clearly understand that I need to have A inverse or 1 by A when I multiply to get 1. Say for example, if I just simplify this, A times of 1 by A is called 1. So A times of 1 by A is equal to 1, but provided I assume with the condition that here A is not equal to 0. A is a non-zero element taken from Q. So this is how I cancel and I get 1. So 1 by A is identified as the multiplicative inverse of A under Q, under multiplication. So here 1 by A or A raised to minus 1 is the multiplicative inverse of A under multiplication. So this is existence of inverse. using the multiplicative identity 1. Next, the next property is commutative property. Now, commutative property in addition was a plus b equal to b plus a for all a and b belonging to Q. So, instead of plus, we have multiplication here. So, if I take two elements a and b belonging to Q, then my commutative property under multiplication states that a multiplied with b is equal to b multiplied with a. The operation here being multiplication. This is how the commutative property is identified. So, these are the basic properties under multiplication, what we have discussed in similar fashion as for addition. The closure property, a dot b must belong to Q for all a and b belonging to Q. The associative property says that a times b times of c should be equal to a times b times of c. The existence of identity says that when I multiply 1 to any element of Q, I get back the original element. In that case being that 1 is the multiplicative identity. In the existence of inverse, when I take an element a belonging to Q and 1 already being the identity in Q under multiplication, then a times of 1 by a or a inverse gives me 1. Therefore, 1 by a or a inverse is called the multiplicative inverse of a. And the last property I have identified in Q under multiplication is for any two elements a and b belonging to Q, they commute. When I multiply a into b and replace the order and then multiply, I get back the same answer. That is how the commutative property is identified. Yes. Now, in case, if suppose I change the operation from multiplication to division or subtraction, say my binary operation here is subtraction, then all the properties would be same, but instead of multiplication out here, I get minus. So, if I wanted to define the closure property under subtraction, then what do I do? I take for a, b belonging to Q, a minus b must belong to Q. So, if my binary operation is, say, division, then my whole property instead of multiplication is replaced with division. So, a and b belonging to Q, a divided by b belongs to Q. And similarly, when I identify the associative property under subtraction, it is nothing but a minus b minus c must be equal to a minus b minus c. So, it is the same property what we are studying in every case of whether it is multiplication or addition or subtraction or division. The only difference being that the binary operation is taken according to the definition what we consider out here. Now, when it comes to existence of identity, yes, there might be some property which defines to give back the original element. Then in that case under subtraction, what should be subtracted here to get back the original element will define the identity. So, definitely I understand that 0 is one element which always gives back A, because A minus 0 is always A. Therefore, 0 is the additive, is the identity under subtraction. So, different operations change and then different operations have different identities and inverse properties varying according to the operations. So, these are the things which we must also understand in comparison to the addition or multiplication. But the most important operations which we are going to study in the present sessions are the multiplication and addition properties. Now, all the four properties which we have identified here, we will try to recap with the different types of sets which we have discussed: the natural numbers, integers, rational numbers, real numbers, whole numbers, etc. So, we'll see how all these operations are going to associate with each of the properties. So, for that, we should understand each of the property with respect to its respective binary operation. The operations being addition, multiplication, subtraction, and division. So, let's make a chart of and then see where it holds and where it does not hold. So, for example, I take here all the binary operations minus, or I take the multiplication, subtraction, and division, the four operations here, and then I take closure property, associative property, identity, inverse, and the last being commutative property. So let's make 5 columns. And study each of the binary operations with respect to this. And the basic sets which I'm going to consider here is the natural numbers, whole numbers, integers, rational numbers, and real numbers. So when I take the natural numbers, let me see if it holds under addition. Yes, I understand that you take any two natural numbers and add them, you get back the natural number. So it holds, natural number holds. So when I write here n, that means it holds for closure property under addition. Now when I take associative, yes, natural numbers hold under associative property under addition. Then identity under addition, it does not hold. Natural numbers do not hold identity property under addition. Can you tell me the reason? Yes, because 0 is the additive identity which we identify, but 0 does not belong to the natural numbers. So you can say, since 0 does not belong to M, therefore this does not hold identity property. Now inverse, no, natural numbers do not hold inverse property, because when there's no identity, the question of inverse does not exist. Inverse exists only when identity exists. Yes, and commutative property, yes, it holds under addition. The same way, if I wanted to identify for whole numbers hold closure property, associative property, it holds identity, but it does not hold inverse property, because you take any whole number, you wanted to find its negative additive inverse, it would be negative number. Say for example, I take 4 is a whole number, but if I take minus 4, which is the additive inverse of 4, does not belong to whole numbers, because whole numbers start from 0, 0, 1, 2, 3. Therefore, I do not have this holding, and then this holds. So same way, I would like to go for the next property, which is integers. Integers very much hold the closure property. They hold the associative property, they hold the identity property, they hold the inverse property, they hold the commutative property. Integers hold all the properties because they have the negative numbers and the positive numbers, including 0. Yes. Now, in the same case, if I wanted to identify for rational numbers, yes, rational numbers also hold in each of the case. In each of the case, it holds. Even the real numbers hold all the properties under addition. So this is how I identify all the different sets holding all the different properties under addition. Then the same way, if I wanted to identify the similar properties under the respective sets for multiplication, we carefully study each of the sets under multiplication, taking into consideration each of the elements of each of the sets as defined respectively in their own means. Now in multiplication, yes, natural numbers hold the closure property under multiplication. Associative property is also very much true in every case of natural numbers taken here under multiplication. Identity, multiplicative identity is 1, and it very much belongs to natural numbers. Yes. But inverse property does not hold in natural numbers, because every element A belonging to natural numbers, the multiplicative inverse is defined as 1 by A, which becomes a reciprocal. Say for example, I take 3 belonging to natural numbers, its respective multiplicative inverse would be 1 by 3, which does not belong to N. And therefore, this is the reason why natural numbers do not hold inverse property, though they hold the identity property, and very much holds even commutative property. Next. What about the whole numbers? Yes, whole numbers hold the closure property, associative property, existence of identity, inverse does not hold, with the same reasoning being for as we have discussed in the natural numbers. So it does not hold here. Commutative property, yes. If I take integers, integers hold the closure property, because you take any two elements and multiply them, you'll get back an integer. Same is the case for associative property. Identity, Yes, because 1 belongs to Z. And inverse, no. The reason being, for these two cases, is a similar case even for Z. You cannot have a multiplicative inverse of 3 as 1 by 3 in Z, because Z has all non-fractional values. Commutative property very much holds in multiplication. When I take Q, yes, rational numbers hold closure property, associative property, identity, and no inverse. It holds commutative, but in this case, rational numbers do not hold inverse property only because of one particular element where the case fails. That is an exceptional case which makes rational numbers do not hold inverse property. If suppose I take 0 belonging to Q, 0 is a rational number. It is part of rational numbers. But if I want to find multiplicative inverse of 0, what is multiplicative inverse of 0? It is 1 by 0. So 1 by 0 does not belong to Q. It is an undefined value. It is an undefined indeterminate. It's an infinity. Therefore, in this case, 0 does not have multiplicative inverse, which fails. Next, similar is the case with real numbers. It holds. This one holds. This does not hold with the same reason as that of Q. And then this holds. Now, multiplication and division are the properties which we practice in the same manner as that for multiplication and addition. The subtraction and division also equally have the same way of following, whether they follow the closure property or associative, identity, inverse or commutative, based on the respective sets N, W, Z, Q and R. So this is how we understand, but out of this, the most important operations which we are going to discuss in the syllabus are the addition and multiplication. So the existence of all the 5 properties with respect to addition and multiplication are understood with this particular table, which makes us understand which set is holding the particular property and which set is not holding the property, including the reasons. Giving the reason for why it is holding and why it is not holding is very important than understanding just by whether it is holding or not holding. So these are the reasons through which I identify that few of the sets do not hold few of the properties and few of the sets do hold few of the properties, strictly based on their respective definitions. So next we are going to discuss on the number line representation, because the different sets and the different properties which we have discussed in the previous session are very much linked with the number line representation. Suppose I take any number I want to represent on the number line. So let's see what exactly is the number line and then see how a given value can be represented on the number line. So it is number line representation which is very important, and hence we will see how the number line representation is done for certain values. Say for example, I have 3 belonging to integers and I want to represent this on the number line. So firstly, we know that the integers are the numbers which start from negative side, so on and so forth. I know that the integers is starting from the negative side, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on and so forth till infinity. So firstly, I'll represent all these values of Z on the number line and then identify the particular value 3 on the number line. And that is how the representation is done. Say, for example, I take the number line always horizontally. In this form. And always the left end and the right end are denoted with arrows, because this leads to plus infinity and this leads to minus infinity without any end on the left and any end on the right. And the exactly middle value is 0, as we all know. And then on the right, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And on the negative side of the integers, I have negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 4, and so on and so forth. So this is the number line representation for Z, where I wanted to represent the value 3 belonging to Z on the number line. So in this case, here I identify 3. So this is where I just circle up. So when I circle this, it is identified that this value is lying at this particular point on the number line. Say I wanted to represent minus 3, or not minus 3, let me take another value, say minus 4 belonging to Z on the number line. So thus, this I identify this here, where I darken. Say I wanted to identify 0.5, which is a rational number, because 0.5 is nothing but 1 by 2, which is in the form of P by Q, with P and Q being integers and Q not equal to 0. So 0.5 lies always between 1 and 2, between 0 and 1, sorry. So in this case, I identify exactly in between of 0 and 1, where 0.5 lies. So this is where 0.5 lies. So in this way, I can identify any value belonging to the real numbers on the number line, and that is what is called the number line representation. And it is very important, because sometimes we need to know in which region or which part of the region the particular value lies, in between what different values of the range. So in this case, I identify that 0.5 lies between 0 and 1, exactly in the middle. In this case, I identify that minus 4 lies on the negative side of 0, where here somewhere, and 3 is identified here. So like that, respectively, we can identify any different number of values using the number line representation. Now, representing the values on the number line is a very easy task, but when it comes to rational numbers, there's extra attention and proper care taken when we consider rational numbers on the number line. So for example, I wanted to represent pi over 6 on the number line. So this is my question. So 5 over 6 is a value which is not fixed, but it is in an approximate decimal representation. Therefore, identifying this exactly is not an easy task. So what we do is we divide the interval in favor of 5 by 6 and then represent it on the number line. So let's see how we can do that. Now, I identify that 5 by 6 is a value which is less than 1, because numerator is less than denominator. So 5 by 6 will always be a value less than 1, and it will always be greater than 0. So 5 by 6 is a value which lies between 0 and 1. So I divide the interval between 0 and 1 in favor of 5 by 6, and then it will be easy then for representing on the number line. Now, for example, let's see how. So 5 by 6 we have identified is a value between 0 and 1. Therefore, I divide the number line in such a way. I start with 0. Of course, on the left side, I have all negative values. Then next is 1 by 6. Next is 2 by 6. 3 by 6. 4 by 6. 5 by 6. And 6 by 6, which is nothing but 1. So the values which lie between 0 and 1 are equally divided in the form of fractions of 1/6. 1 by 6, 2 by 6, 3 by 6, 4 by 6, 5 by 6, and 6 by 6. So in this case, we can easily identify 5 by 6 to lie somewhere here. So this is where the 5 by 6, which is a rational number, lies between 0 and 1. So different rational numbers will have different properties, which we are going to divide accordingly with suitable intervals, depending on the value what is given in the problem. Now, because it's 5 by 6, I've taken between 0 and 1 as 1 by 6, 2 by 6, 3 by 6, 4 by 6, 5 by 6, and 6 by 6. If same way, if I had 7 by 6, then what do I do? If I have, say, 2 by 7, this is a value less than 1. So in this case, I divide the interval as 0, 1 by 7, 2 by 7, 3 by 7, 6 by 7, and 7 by 7. And there the value is identified to be here. So this is how the number line representation is done, favoring the rational number. So it is very important to take care of what fractions you are considering between 0 and 1 when you take a value, say particularly 5 by 6 or 2 by 7. So in this case, let me take a value, a rational number which is greater than 1, and see how it can be represented on the number line. Say I have 5 by 4 greater than 1. So this can be taken in the mixed fraction form as 1 by 4. When taken in the mixed fraction form, gives me 1 over 4, which indirectly can be written as 1 plus 1 over 4. So this is how indirectly I represent on the number line, thus 5 by 4 being represented on the number line. So in this case, let me take a horizontal line where this is 0. This is a value which lies between 1 and 2. So let me start with 1, and the next value being 1 plus 1 by 4, and the next being 1 plus 2 by 4, and the next being consecutively 1 plus 3 by 4, and 1 plus 4 by 4, which is the next integer 2. So the value which lies between 1 and 2 is divided into subintervals as 1 by 4, 2 by 4, 3 by 4, and 4 by 4. Now in this case, 1 plus 1 by 4 or 5 by 4 is identified here at this point. So this is how indirectly I represent 5 by 4 on the number line. So this is how it is subdivided equally. Now let's see another example where how a negative number can be represented on the number line, a negative rational number. So when I understand a negative rational number, it is understood on the left of 0. When I understand the positive rational number, it is something which you represent on the right of 0. So therefore, when we proceed for negative, we start from left of 0. And when we do for positive rational numbers representing on the number line, we start from right of the 0. So, but all the properties being the same. Now, when I take minus 3 over 4, which I wanted to represent on the number line, I clearly identify that it is a negative sign which I bring out, but it is 3 by 4, which is nothing but inside the brackets. So let's see how this can be represented on the number line. I take 0 here because I want all the values on the left of 0 being with a negative number. So in this case, minus 1 by 4, minus 2 over 4, minus 3 over 4, minus 4 over 4, which is minus 1. So this is a value which lies between minus 1 and 0. The least being minus 1 and the highest being 0. So it is in this range of minus 1 and 0 where negative 3 over 5 over 4 lies in on the number line. So I clearly identify that negative 3 over 4 is clearly at this junction of, and this is where I identify the value. So we find that the difference here is, for positive value we go on the right of 0, here we go on the left of 0. So let's see the last case where how I can represent a value which is greater than 1. I mean a value after the sign being greater than 1. So let me take negative 5 over 4, where the numerator is less than denominator. Here a numerator is greater than the denominator. So yes, so in this case I can just represent this on the number line, but before doing that I just convert the 5 over 4 into the mixed fraction, as we already done in the previous case. 5 over 4 in the mixed fraction can be written as 1 over 4, which indirectly is nothing but minus of 1 plus 1 over 4 in the mixed fraction form. So this is the value which indirectly represent on the number line, with the only difference being that the values go on the left of 0 in this case, here they go on the right of 0. So let's represent this on the number line. Here is the 0, and then I represent, I take minus 1, then I take minus 1 plus 1 by 4 minus 1 plus 2 by 4 minus 1 plus 3 by 4 and minus 1 plus 4 by 4. So this inside the bracket, which is nothing but minus 2. So this value lies between minus 1 and minus 2, where I clearly identify that minus of 1 plus 4 by 1 plus 1 by 4 lies somewhere here. So indirectly negative 5 over 4 lies in this region. So this is where I identify the value negative 5 over 4. Now, with all the properties which I have identified in the number line, one learning outcome what comes more importantly here is that there are infinite rational numbers between any two rational numbers, or there are infinite real numbers between any two real numbers. So I identify that. It's a very important note. There exist infinite rational numbers between any two rational numbers. So this is the reason why the number line can be subdivided any number of times into its subintervals, just as we have seen in the case of greater than one case or less than one case, or in case of integers where we can represent on the number line. So the significance makes us come with a learning outcome that there exist infinite rational numbers between any two rational numbers. Now, with this property, if suppose I wanted to take the freedom of writing the question, insert three rational numbers between minus 3 and 5. So I want to insert three rational numbers between minus 3 and 5. So I can insert any number of rational numbers between minus 3 and 5, but for suitable case, let me take any three of my choice. You can take any three of your choice. So I take minus 3, I can write as minus 30 over 10, and I write 5 as 50 over 10. Now I want to consider only the fractional rational numbers. Therefore, I have taken in the form fraction of negative 30 over 10, 50 over 10, which indirectly gives me 5 or negative 3 respectively. So when I wanted to identify three rational numbers between negative 30 over 10 and 50 over 10, I have so many of them, but for my suitable case, can I take minus 27 over 10? Can I take 12 over 10? Can I take 48 over 10 as the three rational numbers between minus 30 over 10 and 50 over 10, indirectly being between negative 3 and 5. So these are the three rational numbers which I identify between minus 3 and 5. So similar is the case where you can identify any number of, depending on the problem. So I wanted to identify two rational numbers between 3 by 6 and 4 by 6. So therefore what I do is I write 3 by 6 as 30 by 60 and 4 over 6 as 40 by 60, thus identifying any two suitable rational numbers between these two. So taking on the number line, I have 30 by 60, which is nothing but indirectly 3 over 6, and I have 40 over 60, which is indirectly 4 over 6, and I want two rational numbers between these two. So I can have the freedom of taking 35 over 60 and 38 over 60 as the two rational numbers between 3 over 6 and 4 over 6. So like this, you can multiply taking any number of rational numbers. If I have the question as take 7 rational numbers, you can choose between 30 and 40 as 31, 32, 33, 35, all over 60s. So this is how I identify the rational numbers within the rational numbers on the number line. Yes, so this is one important concept in number line representation. Even when you take real numbers, similar is the case. The only difference being that the values like root 2, root 3, root 5, etc. cannot be represented on a rational number line. If this is a rational number line, these values cannot be represented. But when you have the values which are in fractional form or in decimal form or in any other strict integer form, they can be represented on a rational number line or an integer number line, depending on the values which you take. So the real number line has all these values considered, but the rational number line does not have these values considered because they don't come under rational numbers. Yes. Now, in the next session, we are going to discuss about terminating and non-terminating integers or values. So let's see what are terminating and non-terminating numbers. So when I have the decimal values, there are two types of decimal values which we identify in mathematics. One is the terminating and the other is the non-terminating decimal. So what is terminating decimal? It is the decimal which has its decimal part has finite number of decimals. The decimal part of the value which you consider here has finite number of decimals, then that decimal is called a terminating decimal. Let's see with an example, but let's also take non-terminating. Non-terminating is the contradictory definition of what we have taken here. So decimal part in this case has infinite number of decimals. So let's see here with an example. Now in case of terminating decimal, if I take 1 by 4, I can strictly divide 1 over 4 to get 0.25. The decimal ends here. So that means if you represent 1 by 4 in the decimal value, it has finite number of decimals in its decimal part. This is the decimal part. This is the non-decimal part. So its decimal part has been counted with finite number 1 and 2. So it has finite number of decimals. But when you take in case of a non-terminating decimal, say I take the example of 1 over 3 and I start dividing this, it never ends. It goes on and on. So the decimal part of this decimal has infinite number of decimal places. So this is an example of a non-terminating decimal. This is an example of a terminating decimal. So usually in non-terminating decimal, instead of writing this infinite number of times, we just write it in the form of bar, which indicates that when I put a bar under 3, the number 3 is repeated infinite number of times. Say for example, I denote a bar under 7, 1, it indicates that the value 7, 1 repeats continuously in equal intervals of time. Say for example, if I write 0, 5, 7 bar, that means 5 is fixed, but 7, 1 repeats continuously infinite number of times. So the bar representation is used for terminating, non-terminating decimals, where the value keeps on repeating after decimal value. Yes. Now when I take the non-terminating decimal, it is also given with the name recurring decimal. So the recurring value, because it recurs on and off continuously, the non-terminating decimal is also called a recurring decimal value. This is one of the example and this being another example. Now, when we discuss on the period for this non-terminating decimal, I first write the definition. Period is the number of values in the decimal part which keep repeating. So the number of digits in the decimal part which keep recurring is called period. Say for example, I take 0.789 bar. In this case, I see that if I remove the bar notation, I can write this as 0.789 89 89 and so on so forth. So I see that these two digits are repeating every time in the next infinite cases. So therefore, because the number of digits are 2 here, the period of this given problem is said to be 2. If I take another example, say 0.5781 bar. In this case, there are three digits which are repeating under the bar. Therefore, the period of this problem is said to be 3. Then what would be the period of this? The period of this would be 1, because there's only one digit repeating. So in this case, different problems which term non-terminate have different periods. Now this is a session where we are going to convert a non-terminating decimal into a rational form. Every non-terminating decimal is said to be converted into rational form by using certain mathematical properties. Now say for example, the heading here is converting non-terminating decimal into rational form. As we already seen that rational form is the expression of a number in the form p by q, where p and q are integers with q not equal to 0. I can represent every non-terminating decimal into rational form. Let's see how we can do that. Say for example, I have a value which I want to convert into rational form, that is p by q form. So this non-terminating or recurring decimal, I can write this as 0.555, as we all know that. That is how the bar notation comes into existence. Now here, let me take the value x as 0.5 bar. So which is nothing but, indirectly, x is 0.55 till infinite times. So if I take the value of x as 0.5 bar, indirectly x is 0.555 taken infinite number of times. Now what I'm going to do is, I'm going to multiply 10 on both sides, then this would be reduced to jump of decimal from here to here, so that I get 5.555 till infinity, which is 10x. Now here, my original x is 0.555 till infinity. So once I multiply 10 on both sides, I take back x here, and then I subtract the two equations, these two equations. So when I subtract, I get 10x minus x with a change of sign as 9x. And when I subtract this, I get 5.00 till infinity. So that this gets reduced further to 9x equal to 5. Therefore, x being equal to 5 over 9. So indirectly, my x, which is 0.5 bar, can be written as 5 over 9. And this is how I understand the difference between terminating decimal and a rational number. So 0.5 bar is said to be approximately equal to 5 over 9. Now here, one thing which we need to take care of, and it's very important here, is that why am I multiplying the both equations with only 10? This is not the case in every problem. In this case, because the bar is only for one digit, I multiply 10 on both sides. If the bar is for two digits, I multiply 100 on both sides. If the bar is for three digits, I multiply 1000 on both sides. The number of zeros would depend on the number of values under the bar. This is very important, and this can be overcome by taking one more problem in discussion. Say for example, if I take a problem 0.78 bar and I wanted to convert this into rational form. Now because there are two numbers under the bar, I multiply x with 100 on both sides. So let's see in detail how we can do that. Now in this case, I further simplify this to be, and so on and so forth. So 78 repeats continuously till infinite times. Now, as with the rule says, there are two digits on the bar, I multiply 100 on both sides. So I get this to be in this form. Whereas indirectly this turns into 78.7878, so on and so forth, because this decimal jumps 2 units to the right. Next. my original x is 0.7878 and so forth.